Hello everyone, good morning. Okay, still waiting for another participant. You can unmute your mic and active your camera. Say hello. Before we start, waiting for a few minutes, waiting for another participant. Okay, everyone, while waiting another participants, before we start the class, let us introduce ourselves. First from me, my name is Didik Sazali. You can call me Didi. I'm from Code Indonesia. It's my team in software development. I live in Bengkalis Regency, Riau. And I hope we can learn together and discuss what we learn from this class together. I think that's it from me. If you want to introduce yourself, please unmute your mic and active your camera. Go ahead. You can introduce yourself. From what campus are you from, and what's your reason following Bangkit Academy? Come on.
Hello.
Hello, Alfian.
Hello, my name is Alfian. My reason to join Bangkit is I want to learn more about machine learning, and also I come from Universitas Hasanuddin.
Oh,
that's it for me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Afian. Another participant, please introduce yourself. Say.
Hello.
Yeah.
My name is Jerry. I'm from Institute Teknologi 10 November and I'm joining Bangkit for learning more about machine learning.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jeremy. Yeah, maybe Naufal.
Okay, hello guys. My name is Naufal Abdillah. You can call me Naufal. I'm from Yogyakarta. The reason why I join Bangkit is to the same as you guys, to learn machine learning with the guide of experts. That's all for me.
Okay, nice. Is there any participant want to introduce yourself? No more? Yeah. Raihan, Universitas Pajajaran. Okay. Just chill out for this class. We can learn and discuss together. If there's no one want to introduce yourself, we can go ahead to start the slide. Oh, this is Nawang from 11 Maret University, Solo. I join Bangkit. I want to learn more about machine learning and I have interest of machine learning. Thanks. Okay, there's Nurul from Universitas Indonesia. Join Bangkit to learn machine learning. Okay, good. Okay. Leja Pianza from Institute of Technology Sumatra, learn machine learning because of general I like technology. Awesome. Okay, can we start for the material? Salma, Universitas Muhammadiyah Malang, yang bangkit dalam promosional ini. Universitas Sriwijaya, I join Bangkit because I want to assume my knowledge and I'm special. Sorry. Okay, well, introduce yourself here in comment. I will share you the slide about configuration, management and the cloud. Okay. Okay, in this session, we learn about configuration management and the cloud. Okay, automating with configuration management. Introduction to automation at scale. Being able to scale means that the system able to keep achieving larger impacts with the same amount of effort. In short, scalable system is a flexible system. Automation is an essential tool for keeping up with the infrastructure needs of a growing business. Automation is what lets the system scale. A configuration management tool can take different roles and apply them to the system that it manages, making changes efficient and consistent. Some popular configuration management systems include Puppet, Chef, Ansible, and CF Engine. For this learning, we learn about Puppet. This is the image for configuration management system. Using infrastructure as a code or IIC means all the configuration necessary to deploy and manage a node in the infrastructure stored in version control, such as we learned about Git and GitHub previously. So the fleet of nodes are consistent, version reliable, and repeatable. It brings all the benefit of version control, include audit trail of change, quickly rollback, review mechanism, and collaboration. Automation and configuration management can help the IT team adapt and stay flexible to embrace the technology industry, which is constantly changing and evolving. Next, about Puppet. Introduction to Puppet. Puppet is a cross-platform open source configuration management system created in 2005. Puppet is currently industry standard for managing the configuration of the computers in a fleet of machines. In the client server architecture, the client is Puppet agent, and at the server is Puppet master. So the Puppet divide into two name. The first is for client Puppet agent, and server is Puppet master. And then this is with client server architecture. The agent connects to the master and sends facts that describe the computer. The master then process the information, generates the list of rules, and send the list back to the agent. Then the agent making any necessary change on the computer. This is the example for simple Puppet role, like programming language. This is there's a class named sudo, and inside the class there's a package, and make ensure it's present. In Puppet, resources are the basics unit for modeling configuration to manage. Each resource specifies one configuration to manage, like a service, package, or a file. For example, a file resource in simple role that ensure that /etc/ctl.d exists, and it's a directory. The directory title is /etc/ctl.d written before colon, followed by attributes to set for the resources. This is the simple role with file resource. So inside the class sysctl, we will make sure that directory is accessed. You can make file /etc/sysd ensure that is a directory. The Puppet agent applies Puppet rules, including the desired state of resource, to the system using providers. When the Puppet agent process the resource, it first decides with provider needs for user, then pass along the attributes that configure in the resource to the provider. The code of each provider is charged of making the computer reflect the state requested in the resource. For using Puppet, use class in Puppet to collect the resources needed to achieve a goal in single place. For example, there lies class with three resources, a package, a file, and a service. All of them is related to the network time protocol or NTP. This would make it easier to exert change in the future since all the related resources together. This is the example is Puppet classes, class NTP, package NTP to make sure it's the latest version. File to make sure, then source is Puppet modules NTP, NTP const replace to true if it then to, and then this to run the set to run the service. NTP enable true to make sure it's running, ensure running. Next is the building blocks of configuration management. Purpose domain specific language or DSL is limited to operation related to when and how to apply configuration management rules to devices. On top of the basic resources types which previously checked, Puppet DSL includes variable, conditional statement, and function, some as like programming language. Puppet flags are variable representing characteristic of the system. Flags generated by a program called FactFactor in Puppet Agent, which analyze the current system and stores the information in flags. Flags is variable, preceded by a dollar sign in Puppet DSL. The first variable known as hash in DSL, like Python's dictionary, is virtual, is one of the built-in facts. It reports if Puppet runs on virtual or physical machine. So it will choose is it virtual machine or physical machine. If the if and else block declared as DSL conditional statement. Use equal greater than to assign value to attributes, it attribute ends with comma. This is the example. If X is virtual, package smart modules ensure purge. Else, package smart modules ensure it's installed. Use of if else in to check its virtual machine or not. Puppet use a declarative language by declaring the state to achieve rather than the steps to get there. Another important aspect of configuration management is the operation should be idempotent. An exception is the resource that runs command, since a command might modify the system each time it's executed or use only if attribute. So this is the example, using only if to change exec attribute become idempotent. To run the file command, this is npm home bankit, example text home bankit desktop, and will run system run if we want to, make an exception resource that runs command, we use only if here, test this e home bankit test example.txt. Another important aspect of how configuration management works are the test and repair paradigm. This means that actions are taken only when necessary to achieve a goal. And lastly, an important characteristic is that Puppet is stateless, which means there's no state being kept between runs of the agent. Its Puppet run is independent to the previous one and the next one. Next is deploying Puppet locally. When testing new configuration, instead of using Puppet as client server architecture, use it as standalone application run from the command line. Install Puppet master on computer. This is the example, install Puppet in Linux based on Debian Linux. Sudo apt install puppet dash master. Use sudo to make super user. Create manifest file to store the rules with .pp extension. For example, create role to make package htop install. Catalog is the list of role generated for one specific computer once the server has evaluated all variables, conditional and function. This is the Puppet manifest tool. Package htop ensure it is present, and then apply roles in tools.puppet.pp. Sudo puppet apply this v tools.pp get v for verbosity output. In resource relationships, the resource types in lowercase when declaring them, but capitalize them when referring them to them from another resource attribute. To apply the rules described in a class called include common. Typically, the class is defined one file and include in it in another. Here is the example resource relationship. We can make the class NTP with the packet, file and service in it, and we can call the include NTP to make the resource relationship. Yeah. Next is Puppet module is a collection of manifest and associated data. here's some of the common files and directories. All manifests get stored in a directory called manifest. Includes special file init.puppet, which defines a class with the same names as the module. The rest of the data is stored in different directories depending on what it does. The files directory include copied into the client machines without any change. The template directory includes files that had already been pre-processed before they were copied into the client machines. Next is, there's a large collection of pre-packaged modules that are simple and ready to use. Let's try to install Apache module provided by Puppet Labs and include it in a module. Use double colon before the module name to let Puppet know that this is a global module. The Apache prepackaged module, sudo apt install puppet module puppet labs apache. Then use the apache module cat web server.pp include double colon apache and sudo puppet apply -v web server.pp to use the apache module. In Puppet terminology, a node is any system where Puppet agent can run. Node definition typically stored in file called site.pp. When setting up Puppet, usually there's a default node definition that lists down classes that should be included for all the nodes. To apply for specific nodes identified by its FGDNs, fully qualified domain names, it also lists the same classes from default. This is the example default node definition, node default, class sudo, and class NTP, web server node definition, node web server.example.com, the web name, class sudo, class NTP. And then deploying Puppet to the clients. Puppet use public key infrastructure to establish secure connection between the server and the client using secure socket layer or SSL. Puppet comes with its own certificate authority, which can be used to create certificate for each client. This is the image for manifest and deploying public key infrastructure. Only for demo purpose, configure Puppet Master to automatically sign the certificate. Set node definition in etc Puppet code environments production manifest site.pp. Sample case to deploy Apache web server to Puppet node webmaster.example.com. This is the configuration on Puppet Master. Sudo Puppet config the section master set auto sign true. And then edit node definition set pp, the output cat the site.pp node web server example.com class apache node default. Install package Puppet on computer as Puppet client and configure as client with config set server to master example.com. To run this configuration, you will run in QuickLabs if I'm not mistaken. Then run the Puppet agent by passing test. Make sure to get a catalog to install and configure the Apache packet. Set the Puppet running automatically, so if the configuration on master changes, client will automatically apply. This is the configuration. We install Puppet and Puppet config set server, the server name, master example.com, and then sudo Puppet agent -v -stats, and we should enable the Puppet service and then start the Puppet service and check the service. Puppet service, is it run or not? With command systemctl status Puppet will show the status of Puppet running or stop. And then updating deployments. To avoid doing mistakes on deployments, there are some options. Test manually on specific test machine. Use Puppet parser validate command and that checks that the syntax of the manifest is correct. Run the rules using noop means no operations. Makes Puppet simulate what it would do without actually doing it. Puppet lets test manifest automatically by using rspec test. In infrastructure context, production is part of the infrastructure where a service is executed and served to its users. One of the cases to roll out chains safely is running them through a test environment first. Also, try to isolate the configuration that the agents see, depending on what puppet environment they're running. Example, mark some users as early adapter or canaries. This node detect potential issues first. Pushing chains in batch instead of pushing the chains to all node. It's a good idea to break the chains to be small and self-contained. And then, Matari about managing cloud. In cloud computing in Bangkit, actually, it is another Matari class for cloud computing for this Bangkit machine learning for the additional information, because it cloud computing always related to machine learning. In the context, capacity is how much the service can deliver. The available capacity is tied to the number and size of the server involved. The capacity change is called scaling. In scaling, in particular, we call it upscaling when increased capacity and downscaling for otherwise. Scale and deployment horizontally means add more nodes into the pool that's part of specific service. Example, add more servers to increase capacity. Scale deployment vertically means make nodes bigger. Example, add bigger disk or CPU. Then automatic scaling is the service offered by the cloud provider will use Matrix to automatically increase or decrease the capacity of the system. On the flip side, using manual scaling means that chains are controlled by humans instead of a software. Next about cloud computing is there's the lift and shift press related to a migration from traditional server configuration to the cloud. There's a lift of the current configuration and a shift to a virtual machine. Public cloud is the cloud services provided third party. Private cloud is when the company owns the services and the rest of your infrastructure, whether that's on-site or in a remote data center. Hybrid cloud is a mixture of both public and private cloud. Multi-cloud is a mixture of public and or private clouds across vendor. That's information about cloud computing, and then is managing instances in the cloud. There's a variety of different cloud providers, each with some specific advantages. Some terms used by one provider might not exactly match with others, while some other concepts are the same. This course uses Google Cloud Platform to demonstrate the examples. To create virtual machine resources, it's available via the web interface or the command line interface. The web UI is great for experimenting, like comparing different options and even show the cost estimation. The command line interface is a significant step towards automation. For automation, there's also a reference image feature that stores the contents of a machine in a reusable format. There lies also a templating feature, which is process of capturing all the system configuration to create virtual machines in a repeatable way and usually save in this image. You can create virtual machine in QuickLabs. And then automating cloud deployments, load balancer ensure that it not receive a balanced number of requests. The simple strategy is just to give each node one request called round robin. Auto scaling allows service to increase or reduce capacity as needed, while the service owner only pays for the cost of the machine that are in use at any given time. So they pay cost what feature or time the server that use it. Next, orchestration is the automated configuration and coordination of complex IT system and services. Related to infrastructure as code, similar to Puppet, there's a Terraform also use domain-specific language to specify the cloud infrastructure to look like and able to interact with many cloud providers and automation vendor. Next, building software for the cloud. Storage services. Block storage in the cloud acts almost exactly like a hard drive. As virtual disk, it can easily move the data around. That's divided into two, persistent storage and ephemeral storage. Persistent storage, for instance, that are long life and need to keep data across reboots and upgrades. Ephemeral storage used, for instance, that are only temporary and only need to keep local data while it's running. Next is object storage or block, binary large object storage to place and retrieve objects in a storage bucket. Cloud providers typically offer different classes of storage at different prices. It depends on performance, availability, and or how often the data is accessed. Data is accessed frequently, cold data is otherwise. Performance storage solution is influenced by a number of factors. Throughput is the amount of data that can be read and write in a given amount of time. IOPS, or input-output operation per second, measures how many reads or write it can do in 1 second, no matter how much data to access. Next is latency, is the amount of time to text to complete a read or write operation. The lower latency is the fastest communication between the server or the client. Next is database service that consists for two, SQL and NoSQL database. SQL or relational database employs the traditional database format and query language. Data is stored in table with columns and rows that can be indexed. Retrieved data by writing SQL queries. NoSQL database has multiple advantages related to scale. It is designed to be distributed across tons of machines and ultra fast when retrieving result. Use specific API provided by the database. Next is load balancer service. A quite common load balancing technique is round robin DNS. DNS configured with round robin will give each client asking for the translation of a group of IP address in a different order. Set up a server as a dedicated load balancer, acts as a proxy between the clients and the servers. Use sticky session to keep track requests from the same client. Such client always go to the same backend server. It also checks the health of the backend servers and servers the geographically nearest client by using geo DNS and geo IP. Some providers dedicated to bring content of your services as close as possible to the user by using content delivery network or CDN. Next is change management is how to make change in a controlled and safe way. Make sure everything is well tested, running unit tests and integration tests, running test tests. Whenever there's a change with continuous integration CI, the system will build and test every time there's a change. Then use continuous development or CD to automatically deploy the result of the build or build artifacts. To test in production with real customers, experience using A/B testing. Learn from failure and build the new knowledge into the change management. Next, about building software for the cloud. Cloud providers often enforce rate limit on resource-hungry service calls to prevent on service from overloading the entire system. Alternatively, for example, try to group all the calls into one batch or switch to a different service. For some of the limits, there's an option to ask for a quota increase from the providers for additional capacity or set smaller quota to avoid overspending. If you want to buy it with lower price, you can small your quota and maximize your setup for your server in cloud. One of the tricks is to have a good monitoring and alerting around the behavior. This is a discussion about monitoring and alerting. To understand how the service is performing, use monitoring. Monitoring check into the history of current status of a system by evaluating a bunch of different metrics. So monitoring system like AWS, CloudWatch, Google Stack Driver or Azure Matrix are offered directly by the cloud providers. Other systems like Prometheus, Datadog, or Nagios can be used across vendors. Some systems use a pool model, which means that the monitoring infrastructure periodically queries the service to get the metrics. Others use a push model, which means that the service needs to periodically connect to the system and send the metric. Black box monitoring checks the behavior of the system from the inside, and then black box monitoring checks the behavior of the system from the outside. Grid automation that checks the health of the system and notifies when things don't behave as expected. The most basic approach is to run a job periodically that monitors the health of the system and sends out an email if the system isn't healthy. On Linux, use cron as the tool to schedule periodic jobs and then pair with the simple Python script. In server, you can use cron job to run the program or the service automatically. Not all alerts are equally urgent. There are typically divided into two groups, namely those in need of urgent immediate attention and those in need of attention in the near future. Next is service level objectives or SLOs are pre-established performance goals for a specific service. SLOs need to be measurable, which means that there should be metrics that track how the service is performing and able to check if it's meeting the objectives or not. Many SLOs are expressed as how much time a service will behave expected. For example, a service might promise to be available 90% of the time. It can be done up to 1% of the time, up to 3.65 days per year. Service level agreement slash is a commitment between a provider and a client. Next is troubleshooting and debugging. Previously, you also learned about the troubleshoot and debugging for the previous material. This troubleshooting and debugging for the cloud. Understanding logs is essential to solve problems IT with service in cloud. Learn where to find the logs. Some cloud providers offer centralized solution to collect all the logs in one place. The more the faulty behavior can be isolated, the easier to fix it. So start from finding the root cause of a problem in the service. Is it caused by an effort on our side or on the provider side? We check the fault. Is it from our side, the client, or the server? Some other alternatives are to bring up the service in the other regions, try on the different machine type, or try to roll back for the system that has recently changed. You can change the previously setting if there's a bug or a fault. If operating a service that stores any kind of data, it's critical to implement automatic backups. Just periodically check that those backups are working correctly by performing restores. It's common practice to have enough servers running at any time, so that if one of them goes down, others can still handle the traffic. On a large scale, you must ensure that the service runs on different data centers or different providers. Therefore, if one of the data center has a problem, the service can still be provided by another data center or provider. Okay, that's for first session. About configuration management and the cloud. Before we continue our session, the second session, if you have any question or something to discuss, please write down in comment or active your mic. I can I cannot give you a demonstration for the PowerPoint because that we should use QuickLabs and where's the to run the service about PowerPoint. Or maybe one of you also has using Puppet before. You can share your experience. Or if you have another question or material to discuss, let's discuss together. And or you can write down your question in comment in dialog box, in chat box. I mean. Or you can also active your mic. I'm to say I think first. Puppet and use case in real world situation. In real for the real world situation, we use Puppet for scale up our server to run it automatically and scaling it automatically. For example here, especially for client server architecture. You can run configuration for the server master and also the host to run the connection or the service from the server and the client using Puppet to whatever the request for the server. Based on automatically and for this goal, the material here, let's say goal is a single place to run the protocol or to run the service automatically. And also, it also can check the system running, is it virtual or physical machine. Difference between AWS, Azure, I think for the best one, not all the service I use that such like Azure or Google Cloud. I ever use Google Cloud for the learning. I think it's more simple using for if you want to build a cloud, building application on cloud, you can use Google Cloud. And if AWS, I AWS, I never use that, or Azure. I think all of them should use. They have their pros and cons, depend on your need. I prefer you or suggest you to use Google Cloud. Because that's all the function, all the what you need about cloud and also machine learning are served there. Is this related machine learning engineer task? Engineer task, maybe I'm not a machine learning engineer. I don't too deep insight about machine learning engineer, what they do. Maybe in my opinion, this is related because if you want to run the server or scale up the server, you can create the program to scale up or the or run the system automatically. You don't need to scale it up manually. I think that's it. I know that's not a satisfied answer. Maybe you can ask for in group or Discord with the machine learning engineer. And then thing to machine learning. Okay. We get to machine learning. In my opinion, we use Puppet, like I said before, to configure the server automatically, not manually, so the process will be better. Or if you have another opinion or another participant have another opinion, you can share here. If no, we can go for the second session. The second session about your Capstone project. Okay, if there's no more any topic or something to ask or discuss, I want to share for the next session. Okay. The next session is about automating real-world tasks with Python. The sixth course in Google IT Automation with Python specialization. Automating real-world tasks with Python. is about your final capstone project in Coursera. This last course will bring the opportunity to put all the knowledge into action with a bunch of small projects based on real-life scenarios. Use Python to write the automation to solve the challenge. Throughout the course, it will give an introduction to the tools and techniques necessary for solving each of the projects. For the last course, it's composed of readings without videos that guide the path of using Python to solve a real-life problem, along with labs to put the knowledge into action. This is about manipulating the image. We will use the Python Imaging Library or PIL. Many developers write a Python module then publish it in Python Package Index. These course modules are about transforming and converting image with Python Imaging Library or PIL. There's a package called PILO, which is a current up-to-date form of PIL. You can install from Linux this package, sudo apt install python 3 pil, and then install pilo. Next, you can import pil. This is the command. Next is about API, application programming interface. Application programming interface or API helps different pieces of software talk to each other. Modules or libraries provide APIs in the form of external or public functions, classes, and methods that other code can use without having to create a lot of repeated code. An API is short of like a promise. When the library's internal code changes, expect the function to keep accepting the same parameters and returning the same result. When a library author needs to make a breaking change to an API, they need to have a plan in place for communicating that change. In general, a good API should be descriptive. While designed, API will follow patterns and naming convention. There's a name convention. This means that the function, classes, and methods should have names that help users understand what to expect from them. When the name isn't enough, the next step is to refer to its documentation. In Python, if the code of module or library is documented using docstrings, use help function to describe a function. Example, help pill. Next is manipulating image. Let's take a sample code from below. This piece of code is pretty straightforward. Even you haven't seen this library before, it's easy to guess what the code opens. And an image called bridge.jpg rotates it 45 degrees and then shows on the screen. This is the pillow API. From pill, import image. Image open bridge image.jpg. And then we'll rotate 45 digits and show it. Next is resize and save the image. When using pill, typically it creates image object that hold the data associated with the image to be processed. With these objects, do operation by calling different methods that either return a new image object or modify the data in the image. And then it ends up saving the result in a different file. For this, resize and save the image. First, it open the example JPEG image and make a new variable or a new object, new im, and then im the first image, resize the width and the height for 640 and 480 pixel, and then new image, save resize JPEG, and this is the new file, resize image. Here's using tuple as parameter as you learn in previous material. Next is combine, rotate, resize, and save image. You can open image, sample image, then you can rotate, resize, and then save. It's easy and simple. And this is the name save new.jpg. Okay, for the next is module one project. The module one is to complete this module, install with Flight 3, then write a script that able to be executed set shebang and slash user slash bin slash environment Python. Can list a directory, then iterate every file on directory. So it lists the directory, iterate the every file on the directory. Use pill to read the image file currently with TIFF format, with the pixel is 192 pixels with the height. Rotate 90° anti-clockwise. Then use pill to resize to 120x multiple 128 pixels, the width and the height. Next, rotate the 90 degree, save as the JPG format on predefined directory. And don't forget to save your code in your local computer. Because lastly, be prepared by saving a copy of the script as well as the script and techniques will be covered in the last module. Next is interacting with the web services. Interacting with web services. A web application is an application that interacts with the user over HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol, which is the protocol of the World Wide Web. Lots of web applications also have API that can be used from the script. Web applications that have an API, also known as web services, instead of browsing to a web page to type and click around, use program to send a message known as an API call to the web service. The part of program that listens on the network for API calls is called an API endpoint. I think common of you know about API endpoint. Next is data serialization. Data serialization is the process of taking an in-memory data structure like a Python object and turning it into something that can be stored on disk or transmitted across network. Later, the file can be read or the network transmission can be received by another program and turned back into an object again. Turning the serialized object back into an in-memory object is called deserialization. In a previous course, we took a list of lists in memory and wrote it to this as a comma separated value or CSV. This is an example of serialization. Most common data serialization formats is JSON and YAML. JSON is JavaScript. Object notation is serialization format used the most in the course. Use the JSON module to convert dictionary or list of dictionaries to JSON format. Next is YAML, yet another markup language, has a lot in common with JSON. Both formats can be easily understood by human when looking at the content. Use the YAML module if you want to use YAML. Then some other common ones like Python Pickle, Protocols Buffer, or the Extensible Markup Language, or XML. A number of web services send message back and forth using JSON. JSON supports a few elements of different data types, string, numbers, objects like Python dictionaries, arrays. With JSON module, use dumps method to serialize Python object and return a string. Use loads method to deserialize JSON into basic Python objects by parse a string. This is the example JSON serialization. Import JSON, this is the people, and here is the Python dictionaries, and then it convert to to the JSON. People JSON dumps people. Will print people JSON will convert into the JSON format. Next, about Python requests. The Python request library makes it super easy to write programs that send and receive HTTP. Here's the example of using requests to make a HTTP GET request for URL with name google.com and use protocol HTTPS. The result is an object of the request response. The response text is the HTML. This is Python request library import request. And the response is request get website google.com, and then print response text is colon 81 will get the split from the 81 character from the google.com. Then the response is okay true, and the response status code is 200 or success. Python request. HTTP supports several HTTP methods like GET, PUT, POST, and DELETE. The HTTP GET method, of course, retrieves or gets the resource specified in the URL. A GET request can have parameters as a form of data serialization. When data becomes complex, it's hard to represent it using query string. This is the example PQ Bankit 2020 response request get google.com and parameters p, and then the response request URL and become google.com and query bankit 2020. Next, about HTTP POST data. Alternatively, of represent query string is using the HTTP POST method. For this will use is commonly used for form input to send the data using HTTP POST. This method sends or POST data to a web service. Example, fill a web form and press submit button. It will send the data using POST method. With Python request, POST request very similar to GET request, only change the parameter attribute with data attribute. Here is the example, JSON name Bankit year 2020, the response POST example.com data.p. This data p for previously use parameter p. Then response request URL, the website, and then response request body name Bankit and year 2020. Next is HTTP POST JSON application programming interface manipulating image module 1. As mentioned before, it's very common to send and receive data specifically in JSON format. With request module, it's simple to change the parameter to JSON. Here's the example. Name Bankit year 2020 response request POST. Here you can see the parameter is JSON. Previously data, here is JSON v. Respond URL, the website, and then respond request body, me name Bankit year 2020. Next is Django. Django web framework. The lab project at the of this module will feature a simple web application created using Django, a full stack web framework written in Python. Django contains library that will help to write apps, code, store and retrieve data, receive and response web requests. Alternative Python-based web frameworks beside Django is Flask, Bottle, CherryPy, Cubic Web, and so on. Next to the second module project. Module 2, to complete this module, use the web server with internal IP address, submit JSON to the REST endpoint, and preview the result. Then write a script that able to be executed, set shebang, user bin environment Python, and list a directory, then iterate every file on directory, first the text file as the input of dictionary, later as JSON format. Use Python request to send JSON with no error. Check the result on the web as before. Lastly, like previous, don't forget to save your code or script to your local computer. And that will be combined in the last module. Next is automatic output generation. You can send email from Python. Sending emails from Python should use the simple mail transfer protocol or SMTP and multi-purpose internet mail extension or MIME standard define how email messages are constructed. Maybe in course quick lab you can try this. In server must be installed SMTP and MIME to run this code. Python has a built-in email module which helps to easily construct an email message from to and subject are example of email header fields. Here's the example Python email message. From email message, import email message, we can use message email message from to and the subject, and we can show the result is from email to who's the sent the email, and then the subject, the greetings. Next, about the after the header, we can make the email body. To continue previous email message construction, add message body, which is the main content of the message. The setContent method also automatically added a couple headers like MIME version. This is the example of email body header. I am learning to send email using Python. Then message setContent body. And then we'll, if you want to show the result, print message will show from email to email with email, and then the subject will show other information about my version 1.0, content type, the text plane, charset, UTF, this 8 content, transfer encoding 7 bit, and also the message in the email body header. I'm learning to send emails using Python. Like that. Next is about to add email attachment. Email messages are made up completely of string. When an attachment is added to email, whatever type the attachment happens to be, it's encoded as some form of text serialized. Label the attachment with a MIME type and subtype in order for the recipient understand what to do with the attachment. This is the example from OS import pet. From MIME type, import guest type. Attachment pet, the source of the file will be attached. And then file name, pet, bad name, attachment pet. The MIME type will guess what type of the attachment attached. We can show the type using print MIME type. We'll show image with format is PNG. MIME type, MIME subtype, MIME type split if you want to get the PNG slash 1. With open attachment part RB as AP message add attachment. This is to read and make the MIME type, subtype, and attachment file name. This is the example of the code to attach an email. Then is SMTP lib. To send email to the computers, use the simple mail transfer protocol or SMTP. In Python, has a built-in SMTP lib module, which helps to easily send an email message. As an example, let's connect to localhost of Linux host, which is already installed and configured as the SMTP server. So you can only try it in your course, because you should configure and install SMTP server in your if you want to run it locally. Python SMTP lib. Import SMTP lib, mail server, SMTP lib, SMTP, localhost, set debug level 1, send message. Message and quit. I think that's about sending an email. The next topic is about generating PDF with Python in every developer. I think always need the PDF or interact with PDF with building a report or make a chart in report using PDF. Generating PDF in Python using a library named ReportLab. There's a few tools in Python to generate PDFs. The course employs ReportLab as it has a lot of different features for creating PDF documents. For example, in the course, mostly use high level classes and methods in the page layout and typography using script, or we can sort it become Platypus page layout and typography using script. This is the example code for generating PDF with ReportLab. From ReportLab, import the Platypus, we can import what library we will use, and then report simple doc template, report.pdf, the style, get sample style sheet, and report title, paragraph, inventory, off-road, style, either one, and then report build, report title. You can also make the table in PDF report. To continue, previous report that only contains paragraph, let's add table to the PDF report. To make the table object, convert the existing food dictionary to list of lists, or sometimes called a two-dimensional array, called build method with list of report title and report table. This is the example code for adding table to PDF report. Word fix, what figures 1, apple 2, durian 3, and table data. This is the list, and then for item, print the table data. And then you can make the table in with ReportLab, Platypus import table, report table, table data table, report build, report title, and report table. This is the example of code. And the next module is about to complete this module, send email from the script, then check the email from the webmail with external IP address. Next, modify the example script with new sender email address and new row of table data. Then check the email result on the webmail. Also, modify the card script with two new calculation from JSON data. Use previous reports function to generate PDF and use email function to send the report. Make sure to check the email and PDF report on the webmail. Lastly, like previous, don't forget to save your script or code in your local computer, else all the script will be combined in the last module. Next, putting it all together. In the past few modules, there are various scripts that have been built with the objects of how to modify image using Python image library appeal, how to insert web service using Python request and sending data in JSON format, and then how to generate PDF files and send emails with PDFs as an attachment. For the final project in this course, all the techniques and concepts above will be combined to build a solution to a complex IT task. This is the final course project. Final project to complete this app, list and iterate files from directory of image and text, write a change image script that able to be executed, send shebang user bin and Python, read image with fill, resize and save to JPEG format, then execute example upload script and check the result on the web server with external IP address and pet URL. Media image. Write a supplier image upload script that customize the example upload script with the data to be listed and iterated from image directory. Next, test the available REST endpoint with sample JSON data and check the result on the web server with external IP address, write a run script that able to be executed, set shebang user bin environment Python list the iterate list and iterate all the files from the directory, parse the data with predefined format and type of the data and to construct the dictionary letter as JSON format. Use Python request to send JSON with no error. Check the result on the web as before. Then write emails, report emails, script that leads and iterate all files from text directory, parse the data, format PDF report as defined. Output the PDF into specified file name and directory, send the generated PDF report as email attachment. The emails and report script similar with the script from previous module project. Then write health check script that get system data with Python library, for example, shutil or psutil. Refer to the documentation to get the CPU, disk, and RAM data. Then construct email with subject depends on the predefined conditions. Use etc host file to verify the local host existence. Install Linux package called stress. Set up multiple connection to the server to run the script with activated stress test. Check the email result on the webmail with external IP address and pet URL / webmail. Yeah, I think that's all about the last material about automating real-world tasks with Python. Is there any something to discuss or ask about this session, the second session? Please go ahead. You can get more understand if you later do the course in Coursera. You can go to practice there about this material. But if you have something to discuss or you can active your mic or write down in chat box. Still confused with the session. For the capstone project. If there is something from my present is not clear, I can repeat again. or if you have a question about technical issue, you can ask our Bangkit team by email. I hope you can finish your capstone project. Or you can ask to Mbak Febria directly, or Mas Ilza. If you have not any question or something to discuss, can we close this class? If there's something to ask or discuss, feel free to write it down in chat box. If not, we can close this class. If you have something not clear, you can watch again the video or read the slides. Okay, Jerry. Hello everyone. If there's no more question or something discuss, I will close this class. A Okay, is it okay? I think that's it for the session. First, I convey to my thanks for all of you that spend your time this Saturday to learn about machine learning in Bangkit program. Hope you can finish your capstone project. If you have something to discuss or issue, you can ask in Bangkit team or ask in Discord and connect me in LinkedIn. And before I close, I'm sorry for my delivery class that maybe that's not make you satisfied or unclear presentation. I hope you can repeat again for the recording video or the slides. Okay, I think that's it. See you in the next meeting if we meet again. Almost midday, and have a great weekend. Have a great lunch for today. Thank you all. Thanks everyone. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.